So what do experts feel about this? I have Dr. Randeep Guleria, Director of the All India Institute of Medical Sciences with me. Dr. Guleria, good evening and welcome. How concerned should we be?
So I think whenever we have a new strain of a virus which suggests that it has mutated, and this strain has had 17 mutations and one of them is at the spike protein, there is a cause of concern that we need to have. It may just be possible that this correlation is by chance, but still I think we have to be very cautious, because especially in countries like India, where we have now seeing a consistent downward trend, we don't want anything to sort of upset the balance and have an increase in the number of cases. So it's something that we need to watch very, very carefully.
Dr. Guleria, in your understanding, how different from the way, how different is this virus from the way we knew the earlier virus?
So viruses are known to mutate, and they tend to mutate, and we know that this virus has mutated to some extent, although not to an extent which has led it to be more infectious or causing more severe disease till this mutation was observed. And when this mutation was observed, the surprising thing was that 17 mutations were noticed in this the genomic sequence, and one of them was at the level at the spike protein, which is used, which is the what the virus uses to attach to the human cells and enter the human cell, and is also part of what is used for the vaccine production. So this caused a cause, this was a cause of concern. What was observed in the UK was that especially in London and the southeast part of London, there was an increasing number of cases. And when they did genetic sequencing of samples from that area, they also observed that this variant was much more prevalent there. This was already being reported in September that there was a variation or a new strain which was there. But then the correlation that was found was that in areas where this was dominant, there was an increase in number of cases. So that is the cause of concern, that this may be a more infectious strain which is spreading more rapidly in the community. But if you look at the data that they have shown, it has not shown an increase in hospitalization or deaths in that area. So we need more data before we can say that this strain is also causing, is more virulent, causing more severe infection. But definitely the data that has been shown by the UK government, or what has been shown in the what is available, suggests that it does cause, is more infectious and tends to spread more rapidly.
Dr. Guleria, then is that the reason that explains, and that is why it becomes more important to take dramatic and drastic steps, maybe like travel ban, which India considered today?
So whenever there's a new mutation, there's always a cause of concern for basically three or four things. One is it more infectious, and will it come enter into a new area where we have a large number of individuals who are still susceptible to the infection, and will that rapidly spread? And whatever effort that has been done over the past many months, including the lockdown, will go to waste, because now we have a new strain which is spreading very rapidly, as is being seen in parts of UK and in Europe. So that is one concern. The second concern is, has this actually is it causing more severe infection in the hospitalization? Will it cause a more burden on our healthcare infrastructure? And of course, will it have an effect on the vaccine? So I think it's really being more cautious and safe before data emerges regarding all these three parameters. And that is why, as a precautionary measure, many governments have taken this step to really buy time to some extent. We must also accept the fact that this is a virus which is spreading. This variant has been there since September. So it's not that it will not come to other parts of the world. But if we can delay that to some extent, till such time that we have more knowledge about it, there's more data, sure, we may be able to act in a better manner.
Okay, Dr. Guleria, now let's talk about the vaccines. Can existing vaccines help against this strain, or will we have to start afresh?
So it depends on what is the mutation and where exactly the mutation has happened. Is it happening at the site which is targeted, where the vaccine is effective and which has been targeted as far as vaccine development is concerned? As of now, whatever data we have suggests that it is not really affecting the site where the vaccine has been targeted. That is a spike protein, except for one variation which this variant has at the N501Y site. But it seems that this is only in one localized area, and the vaccine produces neutralizing antibodies at multiple sites and therefore should be effective as of now. But we, like I said, we need more data to be really sure that the efficacy of the vaccine is not compromised. It doesn't seem so right now, and we will need to see the data that emerges, especially from UK, because they're already vaccinating there. So in the group that have been vaccinated and who get exposed to this new strain, what is the neutralizing antibodies and how do they work against this new strain? That data should emerge quickly, and that will give us more confidence that this new strain will also be, the vaccine will be effective against this new strain also.
Sure. But Dr. Guleria, given the propensity of viruses generally to mutate, I mean, this is something which is not hidden from medical science. Shouldn't vaccine candidates factor this in?
Definitely. So vaccine developers keep this in mind and then try and factor it in, but it's not always possible. For example, we have an influenza vaccine which is available, and that is another respiratory virus. But the virus every year undergoes what we call an antigen drift. It changes itself a little bit and the efficacy of the vaccine falls. And that's why for influenza, we have to have an annual vaccine. Every year one has to get a flu shot, because the virus changes within a year and the efficacy of the vaccine comes down. COVID-19 doesn't change that rapidly as influenza does, but it does mutate. And that is why we will have to see how things work in the next few months, because as we start rolling out the vaccine, it also puts an excessive strain on the virus to really develop or mutate so as to sort of be able to propagate itself and be able to work in a manner that the vaccine may become less effective. So I think in the coming months, not only will we have to vaccinate people, we will have to keep seeing how the virus is behaving in areas where the people are being vaccinated, so that it's not mutating. And if it does mutate, the vaccine will have to change accordingly.
Now, that's important, because you drew a parallel with the influenza vaccine. You think, Dr. Guleria, going forward, vaccines for the coronavirus could be recurring in nature? Is this, according to you, in the realm of possibility?
So it is in the realm of possibility, especially in the early part for the first few years, because we will have to see how things evolve, how the virus evolves. Unlike influenza, COVID-19 doesn't mutate so much, so it's possible that it may not have to be that frequently. The vaccine frequency may not have to be annual, but we may have to give it to some extent. It will also depend how the pandemic pans out. If the number of cases comes down significantly and we are able to control it efficiently, then we may not need to vaccinate that frequently. So these are very important issues which will emerge next year as we roll out the vaccine and we start seeing how the virus behaves once people start getting vaccinated, and in terms of the protection it offers and the mutation that happens in the virus.
All right, my final question, Dr. Guleria, before we let you go, what would your advice be to those in a state of panic after the news of this new strain has come out? There are many.
So I think the advice is that we still need to understand that while we have treatment strategies, while the vaccine is being rolled out, the gold standard to protect us currently is COVID-appropriate behavior. Wear your masks properly, have physical distancing.
That's the only vaccine.
Hand sanitization. No matter what be the variation in the virus, these three things will protect you, no matter what be the mutation that happens. So till we get a better hold in terms of the vaccine, in terms of decreasing the number of cases, we should not have any laxity in these measures, because they will still be very, very effective.
All right. Dr. Guleria, appreciate you, and thank you so much for joining us right here on NDTV.